Okay. Based on the previous analysis for lossless and lossy transmission line, we can conclude that we have three per unit length parameters, L, inductance per unit length, conductance per unit length, and capacitance per unit length, which can be found in form of the characteristic impedance of lossless transmission line, epsilon r and 10 delta. How come? Effectively, the inductance per unit length, it can be obtained as the characteristic impedance of lossless transmission line, which is defined as the square root of L over C, multiplied by square root mu naught epsilon naught mu r epsilon r. How comes? Effectively, this square root is equivalent to the square root of LC in lossless transmission line. And as we mentioned, in lossless transmission line, LC equal mu epsilon. So, effectively, the value of L, it can be determined as square root of L over C multiplied by square root of LC. So, L over C is the characteristic impedance of the lossless transmission line. And square root of LC is the square root of the permittivity multiplied by the permeability of the material between the two wires of this transmission line. So, if I know the characteristic impedance of the line and its epsilon r, and assuming that we are using non-magnetic material, I can find the value of L as Z naught square root epsilon naught epsilon r mu naught. In a similar way, we can show that the capacitance per unit length is the square root of mu naught mu naught epsilon naught mu r epsilon r over the characteristic impedance of the corresponding lossless transmission line Z naught lossless. And we have proved that for the case of a coaxial transmission line, the relation between the conductance and the capacitance is that G equal omega C multiplied by 10 delta. And we mentioned that this relation is valid for any configuration. It should not be only coaxial transmission line. So, if I know the capacitance from this relation, and I know 10 delta, and I know the frequency, I can obtain the equivalent conductance. So, the conductance would be omega C 10 delta. So, by knowing the characteristic impedance of the transmission line and its relative permittivity, or real part of relative permittivity, and its 10 delta, I can determine the equivalent L, C, and G. This is effectively based on L, C equals mu epsilon, so it is mu naught mu r epsilon naught epsilon r, and the characteristic impedance of lossless transmission line is the square root of L over C, or L over C is Z naught lossless square, and epsilon r here is means epsilon r dash, the real part of the permittivity or relative permittivity. Okay. As an example, assume that we have a transmission line which have a dielectric material epsilon r teflon is 2.1, and its characteristic impedance for lossless case is 50 ohm, and its 10 delta is 0.001, and the operating frequency is 10 gigahertz. So, what will be the equivalent inductance, capacitance, and conductance per unit length? We can obtain the inductance L as Z naught multiplied by square root mu naught epsilon r. Square root mu naught epsilon naught is effectively 1 over 3 multiplied by 10 to the power 8. And square root epsilon r is square root 2.2. So, in this case, we can say that the value of L will be Z naught multiplied by square root mu naught epsilon naught multiplied by square root epsilon r. The capacitance C, it would be square root mu naught epsilon naught epsilon r over Z naught. So would be the capacitance square root mu naught epsilon naught, which is 1 over 3 multiplied by 10 to the power 8 multiplied by square root epsilon r, so multiplied by square root 2.1 over Z naught over 50 ohm, so we can obtain the capacitance per unit length. Now the frequency is 10 gigahertz, so omega it would be 2 pi multiplied by 10 multiplied by 10 to the power 9, so this is omega. Omega multiplied by C, omega multiplied by C multiplied by 10 delta would be subconductance. So the conductance G would be 2 pi F omega multiplied by C multiplied by 10 delta. So by applying this, we find out the conductance per unit length. Okay, should be noted here that we cannot determine the resistance per unit length. So this relation effectively determines the inductance, the capacitance, and the conductance per unit length. Now, in terms of the wave number, we said that the wave number is equal minus J gamma. So, the wave number Kz is beta minus J alpha, which equal minus J gamma. And assuming that the resistance is very small, at the beginning, in the case of lossless case, in lossless case, the resistance is zero and the conductance B zero. So, in lossless case, Kz would be beta, and beta in this case would be omega square root Lc. And as I mentioned, Lc is mu epsilon. So, it is mu naught epsilon naught mu r epsilon r. Omega square root mu naught epsilon naught is K naught, the free space propagation constant, multiplied by square root mu r epsilon r. So for lossless case, the wave number Kz equals the wave number of free space propagation multiplied by square root mu r epsilon r of the material between the two conductors. For lossy dielectric material, we can say that in the case of lossy dielectric material, R is nearly zero because we are not taking the conductor loss in our consideration in this case, but we taking in consideration the value of G. So in this case would be J omega L multiplied by J plus J omega C. And as we mentioned, G effectively equal omega C multiplied by 10 delta. So in this case, we are talking about omega square root mu epsilon complex, where epsilon complex is epsilon dash minus J epsilon double dash, or epsilon dash multiplied by 1 minus J 10 delta. So in this case, the propagation wave number, assuming that the loss is due to the dielectric loss only, it would be K dash minus J K double dash, where K dash is the propagation constant due to epsilon dash, and K double dash is the propagation constant due to epsilon double dash. Or in other words, it would be K naught multiplied by the square root mu R epsilon R complex, where R complex here is epsilon dash minus J epsilon double dash. So in this case, As I mentioned, I'm going to replace the conductance G by omega C tan delta. So it would be J omega L multiplied by omega C tan delta plus J omega C. We can take J omega as a common factor, or omega as a common factor. Let us take omega as a common factor. Omega as a common factor. So this omega multiplied by omega would be omega squared. So it would be minus J omega. Here we have JL multiplied by C tan delta plus JC. We are going to take C as a common factor, so it would be LC square root LC multiplied by J, this is J, multiplied by tan delta plus J. So, in other words, we can say this is the square root of minus 1 plus J tan delta, would be minus 1 minus J tan delta. Square root of minus 1 is J. So J multiplied by minus J would be unity. So it would be omega square root LC multiplied by square root of 1 minus J tan delta. We said that LC is mu epsilon dash. So in this case, we can say this mu, and this epsilon dash can come in the other square root. So epsilon dash multiplied by 1 minus J tan delta is effectively epsilon dash minus J epsilon double dashes, because tan delta is epsilon double dash over epsilon dash. So in this case, the wave number KZ, in terms of the inductance per unit length, the conductance per unit length, and the capacitance per unit length, is omega square root mu epsilon complex, where epsilon complex is epsilon dash minus J epsilon double dash. Or in other words, the wave number along the transmission line is the complex wave number inside this media, inside the lossy media, with complex permittivity epsilon complex. Okay? On the other hand, if we are going to take into consideration the resistance per unit length, so the resistance of the inner surface and the resistance of the outer surface are determined in terms of the conductivity of the inner surface as 1 over sigma multiplied by the skin depth of the inner surface, and the resistance per unit length of the outer surface is 1 over sigma multiplied by delta for the outer surface, where the skin depth is the square root of 2 over omega mu sigma. We have discussed this in the previous video. So in terms of the coaxial transmission line, Z lossless is eta naught square root mu r over epsilon r 1 over 2 by ln b over a, and the resistance per unit length is the resistance per unit length for the inner surface plus the resistance per unit length for the outer surface. The inductance, the capacitance, and the conductance are determined in terms of the lossless transmission or lossless characteristic impedance. So L equal Z naught lossless multiplied by square root mu epsilon, and C equal square root mu epsilon over Z lossless, and the conductance is omega C tan delta, and the resistance is directly related for the surface resistance. It is not related to the characteristic impedance of the transmission line. In summary, this is a summary of all the calculation which we have done for coaxial transmission line. The inductance per unit length is determined as mu over 2 by ln B over A. The capacitance per unit length is 2 by epsilon dash over ln B over A. The resistance per unit length is the surface resistance over 2 by multiplied by 1 over A plus 1 over B. And the conductance per unit length is 2 by omega epsilon double dash over ln B over A. Effectively similar to the coaxial transmission line, we can determine the inductance, capacitance, resistance, and conductance per unit length for other configuration like two-wire transmission line, such that the two wires are composed of two cylinders. Each cylinder has a radius A, and these two cylinders are separated from the center to the center by a distance D. So in this case, the inductance per unit length is mu over pi cosine minus 1 D over 2A, and the capacitance per unit length is pi epsilon dash over cosine minus 1 D over 2A, and the resistance per unit length is the surface resistance RS over pi A, where pi A, we have 2 pi A here and 2 pi A here, so by adding 1 over 2 by A plus 1 over 2 by A, it would be RS over by A. And the conductance per unit length, it would be by omega epsilon double dash over cosine minus 1 D over 2A. It is interesting to note that L multiplied by C is mu epsilon dash. And the relation between C and G, omega C would be omega epsilon dash of pi over cosine minus 1. If you look here, it is omega epsilon double dash over cosine minus 1. So omega C over G over omega C is epsilon double dash over epsilon dash, which is tan delta. So, in other words, G equal omega C multiplied by tan delta. So, the relation which we already proved for the coaxial transmission line are applied directly for the two-wire transmission line. In a similar way, the parallel plate transmission line, if we have two plates, each plate of width W, and these two plates are separated by a distance D, so the inductance per unit length in this case would be mu D over W. The capacitance per unit length would be epsilon dash W over D, assuming that there is no fringing field. And the resistance per unit length would be 2R surface over W. And the conductance per unit length would be omega epsilon double dash W over D. And once again, L multiplied by C would be mu epsilon dash. And G over omega C, it would be tan delta. Okay? So, this how to determine the equivalent distributed element per unit length for different types of transmission line by field analysis, and what is the relation between these elements. Okay? So, up till now, we have calculated the voltage and the current as a function of propagation function inside the transmission line. And these propagation functions were determined in complex propagation constant gamma, and this gamma is determined in terms of L, C, R, and G. And also, we determine the relation between the complex amplitude of the voltage to the complex amplitude of the current, which is the characteristic impedance of the line. And once again, this characteristic impedance was determined in terms of LC, R, and G. Then we have shown how the field calculation of this equivalent lumped elements. The question now is, I have a transmission line, I have a real transmission line, and this transmission line would be used to deliver the power from the source to the load. So this transmission line will be terminated by the load from one side and will be terminated by the source from the other side. The question now is, what will be the fields or the voltage and current inside the transmission line in case it is terminated with a load? This is what we are going to see in the following video.